disaster. Because he's coming for a bride that is without spot and that is without wrinkle. And he doesn't make the bride without spot and wrinkle when he comes. The Bible says, the bride hath made herself ready.
Amen.
When she comes. And so we're a long way from that. Nevertheless, time is still very short. He's not about to return tomorrow. You know, people have this idea that, you know, we're going to be raptured and leave the rest of the world behind to the judgment. We're going to be rescued, right? Wrong. We're the rescuers. We're not waiting to be rescued. We are waiting to rescue this world. And then Jesus will come. And so we need to keep, you know, our concepts clear, because they'll affect the way that we apply ourselves in our walk with the Lord. And, you know, the Bible talks about the five wise and the five foolish virgins. Remember that? They were all Christians, right? All virgins. They were all Christians. Five were not ready. And that's 50%, you know, of the church. Five were not ready when the bridegroom returned. 50% of the church, born-again believers, were not ready. Are you ready? Oh, hallelujah. You know, people say, well, it's not God's will for us to have any tribulation. The Bible says, with much tribulation, you enter the kingdom of God. You know, the Bible in Revelation chapter 7 and verse 11, it says, you know, and all the angels were standing around the throne, the elders and the four living creatures, they fell down on the and worship God, saying, Amen, and praise, and wisdom, and thanks, and honor, and power. Then, one of the elders asked me, who are these in white robes, and where did they come from? And he answered, Sir, you know, these are they that have come out of the great tribulation, and have washed their robes, and made them white in the Lamb. Don't be deceived. Jesus is not about to return just yet. There's a lot of work to be done, and there's a harvest to be reaped, a worldwide, global harvest in every nation, every tongue, every nation, everybody will hear the gospel of the kingdom.
Amen.
And only then will the end come. You know, in the Old Testament, Moses built the tabernacle, remember, which had an outer court, a holy place, and the holiest of all, right? Three places. The outer court was the biggest place, right? It was very big. Then they came into the holy place where there was a lampstand and the showbread and the altar of incense. And that was another holier place. But then there was a veil. And beyond that veil, there was another place, right? And the high priest would go in once a year into the manifest presence of God. But most Christians are still living in the outer court. Most are still living in the outer court. All the born again, yes? Some are living in the holy place, you know? They've moved on, they're baptized in the Holy Spirit, and they live in the holy place. But there's another place, the manifest presence of God. Hallelujah. Very few are living there yet. But you know something? You can come into that place, and you can come into that place to walk with God. This is not just for what you call prophets and apostles and those things. You can walk with the Lord.
Amen.
It is for you. There are those who go before. There are pioneers. There are forerunners which cut a pathway through for others to follow them into the same experience. And that's what it's all about. And so, it's important, you know. In Malachi chapter 1 and verse 11, it says, from the rising of the sun, even to the going down of the same, my name shall be great among the Gentiles.
Amen.
my name shall be great in every nation. From the rising of the sun, one end of the world to the other where the sun goes down, my name shall be great among the Gentiles, and in every place incense or worship shall be offered unto my name, and a pure offering, as a pure offering, and my name shall be great among the heathen. Oh, can you imagine every nation, every tribe, every tongue, from the going down of the sun, rising again right across this planet? Worship shall start be ascending to the Lord. These are the Gentiles. Every nation, every tribe, every tongue. But it says a pure offering. It will rise as a pure offering unto the Lord. God is bound by his word, but he's not bound by dispensations. There's been many dispensations of time right down to this present time. Enoch walked with God. If he can walk with God, we can walk with God. God's not bound by dispensations. Bound by his word, but not by dispensations. And so we need to understand that. You know, and Enoch was an incredible person. You know, he lived before the flood. He lived in an incredibly evil time. Great evil and great danger. And he walked with God. You know, the Bible tells us, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days in which we are living now. Great darkness, great light. You know, Enoch lived in the days of Noah. They would have known each other. And seventh generation from Adam, you know. And he saw the coming of the Lord. Way back then, the book of Jude tells us, he saw the coming of the Lord. And he's still been waiting for the coming of the Lord. The spirit of Enoch is available to this end time church. Amen. To walk with God. Enoch found a way to walk with God. And you know, he was translated. Noah and his family went through the storm, but rode above it. That was another level, slightly lower than Enoch. Then there was another group, where the Bible says, those who died in the flood. Let me settle it out. Do you want me to tell you the truth?
Yes.
Well, somebody does. If you're living in the outer court, you will not survive what's coming on the face of the earth. Can't survive in the outer court. We need to understand that catastrophes are coming across the face of the earth. Difficult times are coming. As it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in our day and age. And if you're living in the outer court, not in connection with the Lord, not in a vital connection and union and walk with the Lord, you will not make it. You will die from what is coming on the face of the earth. I'm telling you the truth, you won't make it. Germ warfare is in its infancy, just in its infancy. And there are rogue states around the world now who have vast quantities of chemical weapons. We have to become immune. The law of the spirit of life has made us free from the law of sin and death. You know, John G. Lake. How many of you heard John G. Lake? Okay, John G. Lake in South Africa in the middle of a plague. People were dying all around him. And he came in and the people there who were handling the plague said, you can't come in here. He said, oh, I'm coming here. I want to help these people. And there was a woman dying and he picked the froth up out of her mouth and said, put it under the microscope. And it was dead. The fact that that just touched his hand killed every germ, every infection, every microbe in that whole thing. The law of the spirit of life has made us free from the law of sin and death.
Amen.
We've got to learn to walk with God.
Amen.
We really do. We've got to learn how to flow with him.
Amen.
You know? Oh, the kingdom of God has come. You know that word, that phrase, the kingdom of God.